12, home to the Raw Feed live and rapid-fire topic discussions. You can listen to our shows via live stream by navigating your browser to godlikeproductions.com, or you can listen to our archives located at podcast.godlikeproductions.com. You can also find us on iTunes. GLPBC shows, now in its third year, are produced in our live web-based auditorium where listener interaction and participation is encouraged. We are raw, uncensored, where humans from around the globe can discuss, debate, learn, laugh, cry, get angry, and to speak freely about concerns and issues that affect us all. Join the VC team, Phenomenon, Ragman, Pupnuts, Jay, 2342, Kingman Art, Isis 7, Kung Fu, JDO, Yobo, Libertine, and DSNBC. Because GLPBC, like a poker hand, gets it to you straight. Enjoy the show. Good evening, GLP, to those listening on the live streams and to those who download off iTunes. Welcome to GLPBC's The Raw Feed. Today is Thursday, June 7th, 2012. Tonight's guest is Dr. Paul LaViolette. He's an interdisciplinary scientist. He's authored several books, Secrets of Anti-Gravity Propulsion, Subquantum Kinetics, Earth Under Fire, Genesis of the Cosmos, Decoding the Message of the Pulsars, and Galactics, Superwaves, and Their Impact on Earth. He's also editor of A Systems View of Man. He's published many original papers in physics, astronomy, climatology, systems theory, and psychology. He's received his BA in physics from Johns Hopkins, his MBA from the University of Chicago, PhD from Portland State, and is currently president of the Starburst Foundation. You can find out more about our guest in the pinned thread on the front page at godlikeproductions.com, or you can navigate your browser over to etheric.com, spelled etheric.com, and starburstfound.org. Tonight's VC team, Jay, producer, Isis, live listener questions, Hubnuts, our audio streaming and podcast engineer, myself, Finn, on neg duty, and Mr. Buzz Lightyear himself to infinity and beyond, 2342. Rex, let's welcome our guest to Godlike Productions.
Awesome. Thanks, Finn. Dr. Paul, really appreciate you making it out tonight with us. How are you doing, sir?
Very good. Happy to be here.
Great. We're happy to have you, and we've got a full house tonight, so really appreciate it. So I'm going to jump right in. I know we don't have a whole lot of time tonight. Really gracious enough to spend an hour with us, and I've read through some of your works, and you've got quite a library of different texts that you've put together over the years. And I also noticed that you are responsible for an organization called Starburst, which deals with, correct me if I'm wrong here, but a ETI-type communication where you guys are working the system out, creating pulsars that can do some type of interstellar communication, basically. Is that correct?
We're not actively working on that, but I have written about that. It's one of our projects that we would like to do more on. We do have a project that if it could get funding, we could do a communication, set up some communication beacons, but that's not active right now.
Yeah, okay, I see. And as far as the work that you do and the research that you get into, several different topics that I've noticed, they're all fascinating to me and many of our listeners on here tonight. I was wondering if I'm trying to figure out where we should start because you've just got so much information here. But why don't you tell us just real quick a little bit about yourself and, you know, what got you into the type of work that you do. I'm looking here that you've just got several different degrees in everything from physics, astronomy. You've studied climatology, systems theory, psychology. So, you know, great stuff to get into here. Yeah, just tell us a little bit about yourself and we can kind of move on from there.
Well, I've always been interested in science and particularly physics, astronomy. I'm interdisciplinary, so I don't stick in one field. My PhD was in systems science, which really can be applied to all the sciences, even business, education, all these areas systems theory has gone into. And so I have worked in a number of fields as a result. Yeah.
Great, yeah. And it looks like here that you used to consult Fortune 500 companies in ways to stimulate different innovations. And I'm curious, do you do anything with different types of energy systems that, you know, are maybe Tesla-type technology? Do you get into anything like that with some of your work or not?
No. In the energy area, it was just conventional solar. But for actual application, yeah.
Okay, so yeah, so you specialize in solar then. Maybe we could talk about that. Let's for somebody like myself that would like to get off the grid as much as possible and have an energy system that's efficient and affordable and self-containing, especially being out here in Texas. You know, we get so much sunlight out here. Is it practical to put together your own self-sustaining solar system? Energy system, and would you put it like up on the rooftop? And do they have shingles now that you can use for solar power?
Actually, you know, that was a project we worked on, solar water desalination, but that was 7 years ago. I'm not doing work in that. I consider solar sort of passe. It's not the best way to go right now. Something like hydrogen power, free energy hydrogen power. Like I know one German company that has developed a hydrogen generator that's over Unity. So something like that could revolutionize the world. Then there's the, you're maybe familiar with the invention of Rossi and Defkalian out in Greece. That's a coal fusion generator. Yeah, there's a lot of.
How does that work exactly? A coal fusion generator.
Well, the one Defkalian has running burns nickel. It converts nickel into copper. The reactor they got is like 9 of them. They'll run the system for about 5 years. Before you have to change the fuel rods, and the thing would probably fit on your breakfast table, so small. So, I mean, it's quite revolutionary.
And what type of energy will something like that produce? So you're saying it's something you could fit on the dinner table. It's about 5 years before you have to change the so they're like rods, basically, and it extracts the energy, turns them into something else in return. That's the byproduct of it, basically?
Well, it produces heat, so you could heat your home. Right now, they're still gearing up for production, I understand. There's a lot of interest from different countries. I haven't seen it myself, just pictures on the internet.
Just to let you know here, I don't know if the men in black are, filtering this call, but as soon as you started to tell us how it worked, your voice was going in and out, and I don't think anybody could make what you were saying. Start over one more time?
It burns nickel. Did that come through?
No. Yeah. Paul, is it okay? 23, we're getting a lot of static coming over from him. Paul, is it okay if we call you on the phone number that I have for you? Your connection with us is breaking up.
Oh, okay.
Okay, everyone. Back to you, 23.
Okay. So Paul, before we got interrupted by the famous men in black, I asked you how the process of cold fusion works. You started to explain it, and we got as far as it uses nickel, burns nickel, and then it went into this, crazy sounding, nothing, couldn't pick up anything you said. So please continue.
Okay. Well, it converts nickel into copper. And there's only a couple isotopes in the nickel that it converts. So basically, it's burning maybe 1% of the nickel. So after 5 years when you change the fuel rods, you've only used up 1% of their weight, which is really amazing that you can heat your home for 5 years and have lost only 1% of your fuel. Well, that's typical of nuclear reactions, you know. They have some catalyst, which they don't say what it is, so that's confidential. And it basically puts out heat.
So. Well, what I'd like to know is, obviously, nuclear reactors are so dangerous, and the spent fuel that is the byproduct of these fuel rods is you know, just horrible stuff, and it's very difficult to get rid of it. They always talk about, you know, burying it, whatever, but it just has such a long shelf life, obviously, and it is so bad for biology. And when you have catastrophes like what happened in Fukushima, Chernobyl, and, you know, there's small disasters all the time where radiation gets leaked out of the atmosphere nuclear reactors.
This is entirely different. This is cold fusion.
Great. So what you're saying is this cold fusion process, the byproduct isn't going to be radioactive death. What is the byproduct?
They do produce gamma rays, but a shield takes care of that. But it has no radioactive waste, which is a nice thing.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, the other device in Germany that I have witnessed a demonstration, it was producing like 100 times over unity. That produces a burnable gas, kind of a hydrogen-oxygen type of gas. So you can use that to run an engine to generate electricity, for example.
And I've also seen automobiles that use a engine that runs off of compressed air. You know, you can run vehicles off of French fry oil, you know, vegetable oil, yeah. Hemp oil, water. So that there's so many different ways to run systems now. When is it going to really start going mainstream, or will we see that in the near future? Just because, you know, these corporations that have so much control and have so much money invested in these ridiculous fuel systems that are just so bad on the environment. But anyway, you know, in the work that you're doing, are you getting any, I mean, are you meeting politicians that, you know, have an opportunity to change things, pass a new bill, talking to people that are, you know, in the aristocratic circles that actually, you know, can make a difference as far as this empire that we live in, or is it more just your own research? You're writing books. You're trying to get the public out there to know about it and just spreading the word.
Yeah, I'm more writing books and developing theories. I felt it was my duty as a citizen to contact Department of Energy. I was in Washington and I had sent them a letter hand delivered through one of the Department of Energy people offering to come in, talk to them about these types of technologies. They weren't willing to respond, and I tried several times, including telephone calls. So I think that pretty much says it, that the U.S. government is not supporting this type of alternative energy.
Absolutely. It's horrible. It's absolutely horrible. And anybody that hasn't read the book Atlas Shrugged, read the book. Or if you don't want to read an 800-page book, just watch the movie. It's a good movie. It's about 2 hours, and it'll give you a really good idea on what's going on. If you've got these innovations on how to make better fuel sources that are more efficient and don't require so much of an energy source that, or, you know, an endless supply of something you have to pull out of the ground or whatever, and they can produce these energies, that the people that rule the world don't want that to get into effect, because if that happens, then it takes away their power, their patents, the money that they have. So that's really unfortunate that you went out there, you actually did something, tried to get the people that are in control of the energy to look at it, the Department of Energy, and they didn't want anything to do with it. So typical, and it's unfortunate. And now, hopefully, with, you know, the internet and as many people that are waking up and the technologies that are getting released out to the masses, you know, people will start doing this stuff out of their garage or, you know, make their own laboratories and really get this these technologies out into the mainstream. And then when that happens, you know, you've got a new renaissance, and there's going to be completely new, entire new economies. So it's still going to be a wonderful thing. And people that say if you take away these you know, take away the fossil fuels and the oils and stuff like that, it'll really hurt the economy. Well, that's not true. You just change the economy, you turn it around, and you add new systems into place. So you know, this is fascinating, and I really appreciate the explanation on that. I want to get into the next topic now, and that's the work that you've written about recently. And I think the most recent book that you wrote is called Subquantum Kinetics, or that you're doing work on subquantum kinetics. And I was wondering if you could explain to us what exactly that is.
Okay, it's a new approach to physics. It's entirely different. Come to different. Entirely different view of the universe. For example, cosmologically, the universe would not be expanding in this physics. And actually, I've done published papers about it that shows the universe isn't expanding based on actual data. You don't have black holes. Matter is created continuously. So even right now, the universe is being created. Energy is being created. Geothermal energy, most of the geothermal energy is actually spontaneously created in this theory inside the Earth. About 15% of the sun's energy is not from nuclear energy, it's from genic energy. I had to coin a new word to explain it. The thing is that energy is not conserved. You know, physics, they say, energy is perfectly conserved. In other words, if you had a photon and you came back a billion years from now, it would have exactly the same energy in standard physics. In the physics I've developed, energy is slowly increasing in our galaxy. So it's like putting money in a bank and you get interest generated. So every body, every celestial body is producing energy. And the more massive the body is, the faster it's producing energy. It's also growing. All celestial bodies, the Earth, the Sun, they grow very slowly. This theory is a unified field theory. It begins with the idea of an ether, which is a new concept. It's not like the 19th century ether theory. It's a sort of reaction kinetic ether. It views the ether like a reacting soup. There are three equations that basically, that's it. Very simple. We've modeled them on the computer. We've been able to produce from them what we call dissipative solitons, which are basically subatomic particles. You know, in other words, we've modeled the neutron, for example, and it checks with, there have been done experiments to find out what is the structure of a neutron. Like they've scattered particles off of neutrons, and based on that data, they've kind of been able to see how the field of the neutron at the core, how it's structured. And our model exactly predicts what they found. And actually, it was published prior to them doing their observations. So actually, the observations that they got were actually a confirmation of subquantum kinetics. Subquantum kinetics has had over 12, well, I've listed 12 confirmations. There's more. I just haven't had time to write them all up. They're posted on the websites, if you go to the websites that were mentioned at the beginning. Also, there's information there about subquantum kinetics. It leads to a new idea of gravity. With subquantum kinetics, it explains exotic space propulsion technologies, what we would call anti-gravity. Anti-gravity is not exactly the correct word, but it's the ability to control gravity. If you stick with standard physics that they teach in the universities, you're always going to be flying jets and will always be sending rockets out. If you want to go to the kind of stuff you see in Star Trek, you have to study subquantum kinetics. That's what gets us to the next level.
Well, and I also know, I'm sorry, there's a little bit of a delay there. I was just going to add to that, that it's pretty common knowledge that atoms are over 99.99% hollow. So there's so much empty space within us and matter. It's interesting how it feels solid, because it's really just electronic frequencies oscillating in harmony with each other. So at the quantum level. Now, with this research you're doing, and now you're talking about Star Trek type stuff, now this is incredible. And I would like to know, some of your theories, because obviously your mind is really geared towards this, just these concepts that most people have a very tough time even imagining, because it's so far outside of the normal paradigm of typical everyday reality and what people live, in their lives. So can you say this is the kind of stuff people need to study to get into these, Star Trek type scenarios where we can travel the stars, we can create these free energy or these devices that can power ships to just travel the cosmos. How do you do a comparison to that? I mean, are you talking teleportation kind of stuff? I know China right now, I've read several articles where, this is a new one even recently, where they can actually transfer protons several miles away. So they're actually working on quantum teleportation right now. And what if they get to the point to where they could send in some type of, nuclear weapon into the, onto U.S. soil without even flying an airplane over? That's the kind of stuff that's probably got the Department of Defense, up all night figuring out how they're going to block those kind of things.
That's not an area I've worked on. But the theory does explain quantum entanglement, where, like, if you have two particles that are close together and then you separate them, they're still bound together. So if you change the spin on one particle, the other particle flips in accordance. So it's like they're operating as a unit. And they've done experiments where they've separated the particles by 100 miles and they're still connected. And the information is transmitted at hundreds of thousands of times the speed of light. So anyway, subquantum kinetics can explain that in a very easily understandable fashion. Standard physics cannot. With standard physics, it's all mumbo jumbo, and you have no concrete understanding of why it occurs. They just say it occurs.
And I also read, I was looking at your one of your websites. I know you've got a couple that you are a part of. I think it was either the etheric.com or starburstsound.org, where it had something to do with, I think it had something to do with what you were talking about how the universe doesn't expand, but you say everything still grows. So if the universe is just a constant size and it isn't going to ever grow, it will stay a finite space and everything within it will continue to grow, what happens, a googoplexing amount of years later when everything has grown to the point to where it's all pushing each other, like being stuffed, like stuffing a bunch of clothes in a closet and trying to close the door, it won't close?
Yeah. Well, if you go that far in the future, first of all, the universe, the physical universe, has been around for trillions of years, so that's something you won't hear from standard cosmology. Because there was no Big Bang, there was no single time of creation. Time is infinitely long into the past. If you want to say, when did the first particles emerge in space, you'll probably have to go back trillions of years to get those first particles, because the whole creation took place very slowly. It's been accelerating. Right now, we're in an exponentially increasing period where the amount of matter is probably doubling every 5 billion years. So if you go far enough into the future, it would get quite crowded with galaxies being a lot more galaxies and a lot larger galaxies than we see today. Yeah.
Yes,
but that's not you shouldn't let that worry you, because basically
I'm claustrophobic. Just kidding. I'm sorry, Paul.
In subquantum kinetics, and I believe this is the way things are, there's more than just the three dimensions. There's the higher dimensions, and I believe the soul is more higher dimension than what we really can see here. You know, in other words, there's whole other worlds out there that are not at the level of the physical. You know.
Right.
And we can't really say too much about that until we die and find out directly. All we can do is talk about what's here and create reasonable models for what's here. And to create a reasonable model about what's here, you have to admit that there is a higher dimension and that there is a flux that's a higher dimensional flux coming, like a river coming into this physical space we're in and leaving. And that ties in with the ancient Eastern views and Heraclitus, the ancient Greek philosopher Heraclitus, who was saying that the essence of existence is basically flux. You know? So these are things that are foreign to contemporary physics. Standard physics believes in structures like quarks and things that are sort of like static structures at the very bottom. So subquantum kinetics instead views process as the basic thing. And when you have process, you can structure, you have structuring of process into these loops. And it's difficult to explain on the radio. Or on the, just over voice, you have to see pictures of this, but it's it all fits together. And basically, the ideas are similar to how your body runs. They're very—it's biological, it's chemical based. In other words, you have to use analogy. What you learn in chemistry and biology, you bring that over into physics. So instead of, well, standard physics is based on mechanics, so you have to get out of that paradigm and now bring in concepts that have been developed in chemistry, for example. But you're not dealing with chemicals, you're dealing with etherons, you see, etheric reactions.
Well, and another thing I wanted to ask you about as well is the possibility of this entire, you know, physical makeup of reality that people consider to be solid mass, basically, you know, when you look at it at the quantum level, once again, it just does break down into these electric frequencies, these oscillating frequencies, protons, neutrons, electrons, and there's all this empty space. So that would maybe explain how there could be these different dimensions and whatnot all, like, being within each other, if that's making sense, but not bothering each other because they're holographic. Do you subscribe to the holographic nature of the universe, like the electric universe theory?
No. Well, that's another way of seeing things, but subquantum kinetics is not based on that. It has its own basis. Subquantum kinetics was formulated by taking systems concepts and applying them to physics. Systems theory it was created by studying originally the human body, you know, to understand, because here's a level where we can see what's going on. In physics, you can't, because the level is so far removed from us. It's way down at subatomic level or way out at the cosmological level, too big for us. At least with a human body, you can study things. And then it was also, system theory was applied to study society. And that's also a very direct experience for us, because we can study our social interactions and we form theories about it. Well, as it turns out, there's some basic principles that apply to systems in general, and we don't see those rules are not broken. Physics was sort of created in isolation from this knowledge. It grew out of mechanics. But when you apply systems theory, you say, well, systems like particles, like neutrons or protons, should not be any different than a system like a biological organism or a society or whatever system. And in fact, that's true. Nature is essentially does things the same way at different levels. It just changes slightly at the various levels, so you get different types of systems. But the basic idea of a structure forming from an underlying process is the same. And when you do that, all the problems we're having in physics disappear.
And, you know, just one of the things that I've noticed in the research that I've done as far as the, you know, reality that we're a part of, it seems that we are a part of the construct of it as well. Like when you look at the double slit experiment and how just being the observer will actually affect the outcome of what you're observing. How does that intertwine with your theories of the subquantum kinetics?
Yeah, it explains the wave-particle thing, but it requires no dualism. In subquantum kinetics, you don't have the particle being a particle one moment or a wave the other, depending on how you construct the experiment. Subquantum kinetics predicts that the particle, the proton or the electron, is wavy. It's a wave pattern itself. And such a wave pattern will scatter and reproduce the what they observe. And I've shown this, that the equations come out exactly as they observe. It's what we call a soliton. It's a particle, but it also has a wave pattern to it.
So it's like it's all connected. There's this giant wave there. However, because of the tools and the sensory perceptions that the observer has access to, that observer is going to see it as a particular dot or a proton or an electron or whatever. But it's really this interconnected giant string that's all attached to everything, and we're all basically a part of the same consciousness or entity or life force or whatever you want to call it. There's just different vibrations and different waves, per se, and that's why we perceive it differently based upon our mental construct. Does that pretty much sum it up?
Whether based on your mental construct it would make a difference? Well, for example, you would have to change your concepts in order to start seeing things in subquantum kinetics terms. And once you get into subquantum kinetics, you start understanding things that you couldn't understand in physics. So there is that psychological aspect. But I don't think that, it's another question whether the observer influences the observed. Of course, when you measure something, you influence it. But that's understandable. You know, whenever you take an observation, what we are, we're like made out of ripples. All our instruments are ripples, and what we're observing are ripples. And we shoot ripples at other ripples, and we observe the results. And so you're going to have to affect it at some point, at some level. But that still doesn't stop you from getting a clear picture of what's going on. You know, the problem is physics has gotten away from a good conceptual model, and that's what subquantum kinetics offers. You have to get away from the idea of thinking of space being empty. You know, it's not empty. it's full of the ether. And wherever the ether is smooth and uniform, it appears to us as being a vacuum. But that's only an illusion. The truth is it's full of the ether. It's sort of like we're in a sea. And wherever there's waves in the sea, that's where matter and energy is. But we don't see the water, you know. The waves can only see other waves. They can't see the water that the waves are in. I don't know if you follow what I'm saying.
Absolutely, yeah. That's a great way to put it. I completely understand that, and I'm sure our listeners do as well, and I appreciate that very much. Another thing, too, that I've often wondered with the research I've done for the past 20 years or so, when you look at the overall scheme of things and you see particular number patterns throughout nature, you know, you see sacred geometry like the Fibonacci sequence throughout nature and octagons and different geometrical patterns and shapes, and it's so fascinating. And then you look at some of the large iconic events that have happened throughout known history, even just the past few hundred years. Let's just get into the similarities between like John F. Kennedy and Abraham Lincoln, and not only their lives, what happened in their lives, the people that were surrounded in their lives, they would have the same names, the same amount of kids, their friends had the same names, the same hobbies, the same interests. And I mean, just the amount of similarities, if you were to look at it as a statistical standpoint, is insanity. So I don't even know what kind of number you could put towards something like that. So when you see all of these similarities and connections and synchronicities, and you get into the ability of the sixth sense where people can, you know, tap into future events, past events, the military has spent millions of dollars on remote viewers that can tap into other parts of the world, other parts of the galaxy, and they can prove without a shadow of a doubt by documented photographic evidence to verify what they saw, that they did actually see what the photograph took in their minds. And they have classroom applications to do this kind of stuff, and that really explains the spirit and the soul, that it does exist. And it is, as you say, this, you know, ethereal realm that is all in front of us. It's just our perception that perceives what part we can compute at that moment. So, you know, this is incredible, absolutely amazing information. So with that said, what do you do with this kind of information? And if this is the key to life, and I did see that picture that on your website of the atom and these, you know, the way that the electrons or protons were coming out of the center of the atom, and there's speculation that these particles come in and out of this particular existence and might go into another one. So do you think that there's like constant flow of information coming in one dimension and out another dimension, like we're in this multi-universe type deal, and there's we have infinite doppelgangers, similar to the TV series Fringe, where you've got the dual universe? You know what I'm talking about?
It's sort of like we're in a river. But we can't see the extent of the river. It's like we're at one point in the river. So this whole three-dimensional universe of billions and trillions of light years is essentially one point in this fourth-dimensional river that flows through us. I used to try to visualize this. It would take me took me months just to try to kind of get a way of grasping the idea of this higher dimensional dimension. This, I call it the transmutation dimension, the dimension along which this etheric process transmutes and reacts. Basically, if you were to move in that dimension, you'd leave your body. In effect, you'd go to, let's say if you went up, you would go, imagine leaving the physical universe, but not moving in space. I don't know if you can picture that. And going to some place that's higher up, you know, in stages. So that would be an exercise you could do to try to grasp moving along a higher dimension.
You talking about OBE, like out-of-body experience, projections?
Well, I don't know. It depends what kind. With out-of-body experience, you could still be in three-dimensional space. You just left your body. In this, you would actually leave the physical universe. You wouldn't be here anymore. You would be somewhere else. A good short story to read, it's called Flatland. I don't know if you've heard of it.
I have heard of it, but I haven't read it.
Yeah. It's a circle is talking to a sphere, you know, and the circle lives in Flatland. And he's discovering that there is more than just flat land, that there is three-dimensional space, and he meets a sphere, and they have a conversation. Well, if you take that same conversation, you know, and apply it to us, you know, you come to the understanding that there's a fourth dimension, the possibility that there are higher dimensions. They're difficult for us to visualize, with time, you can begin to visualize that.
Yeah, yes, indeed.
As far as applications of subquantum kinetics, one of the main things is it says, that thing is perfect energy conservation, that energy can be created. So, for example, where you have devices that produce more energy than that the output seems to be greater than the input, which physicists would say, oh, that's impossible. It violates the first law of thermodynamics. In subquantum kinetics, that is possible. And I show, for example, that stars routinely violate that law. And if they didn't, you wouldn't see the data the way it is. And I've published papers on this, and scientists have agreed that it's correct. Then if you take it to another level, it can explain some cold fusion devices, like the one that Black Light has developed, Randall Mills. Also, John Eccles had developed the same technology in England. And it's a way of heating water, pulling energy out of water itself. It involves a different view of the hydrogen atom, that there are more orbital levels in the hydrogen atom than standard chemistry acknowledges. So that's something that comes out of subquantum kinetics. The electron ends up being, the orbital electron in the hydrogen ends up being a lot smaller than physicists and chemists had thought. Then you can apply it to space propulsion. It explains Townsend-Brown's technology, what's called electrogravitics. You find that there's a connection between the electric fields and gravitational fields. Explains the B-2 bomber's propulsion system, for example, which is highly secret, but I had reverse engineered it, and it's explained in my book, Secrets of Anti-Gravity Propulsion. Then there's other types of field propulsion devices, like that will produce vertical lift. You could screen gravity, for example, is another. You could change the inertial mass of a spacecraft. What else? It explains Plotkin's gravity beam experiment. Eugene Plotkin in Finland, he produced a device that will project gravity impulses, and he's able to make books fall over at 2 kilometers distance with this beam. So it exerts an impulse. And with something like that, you could develop an interstellar drive for a spacecraft.
Well, that sounds pretty cool.
Yeah.
I was just going to add to that, too. Oh, I'm sorry about that. Paul's got just a slight delay. I was going to add to that. That reminds me of the movie Dune, when Leto Atreides is out in the sand dunes where there's like on the planet Arrakis, and they're fighting these, you know, the Harkonnen and the bad guys to protect their spice fields, and they've got these basically this technology that integrates the power that comes out of their voice, the frequency, the energy, the vibrations that comes out of their voice, and it connects with the weapon that they have to create like this sound beam. And the stronger they are personally with their, you know, voice and the vibrations, the more powerful they can release this, you know, sound cannon to take out entire buildings or just in, you know, an individual. So it would be cool if you could like integrate man with machine in that aspect and do this like interstellar travel. But it's as if I've heard people speculate that there's as much energy in just one atom that you could power, you know, the entire planet for an infinite amount of time just because it's all locked within itself. Are you familiar with those theories? I'm sure you are. And is that just hogwash, or is that actually, is there some merit to that?
Well, I would say it's in the ether, you know, it's the reactive flux. Because the ether continually is generating all the matter in the universe. So if the ether flux were to cease, everything would dematerialize. So think of it that way. Yeah. That the table in front of you is this very minute being created by this flux. It's sort of like when you look at a river and you see a place where the ripples are forming because the water is going over the stones. Imagine that ripple is this table in front of you. Now, if the water stopped flowing, that ripple would disappear, but just the same way the table would disappear.
I see that. Okay. That's a good way to explain it.
The esoteric philosophy, the theosophist Annie Besant and Charles Leadbeater, they actually did some psychic investigations of the subatomic realm, and they saw this happening, this process, this flux, creating the particles continually.
Well,
and they
Please continue. I didn't mean to interrupt.
No. Yeah. So, it's a different view of things.
So let me ask you then, if this, all of this information, you know, like the table is being created and it's coming out of this flux of the ether, such as everything else that we see as physical matter all around us, you know, what does that mean? I mean, let's look at this for a second, I guess, on the spiritual side of things, if we may, and you know, say, okay, so with all of the connections and synchronicities and the sacred geometry found throughout the universe and all of these connections of these events and you know, people that we might look at as icons or great leaders, I mean, it seems as if they're all orchestrated at these higher levels, or, you know, are they like demigods? Is there like a programmer and we're in like this holographic hard drive or like this basic, like this simulation, and there's certain algorithms and programs that are embedded in our DNA so that we will respond certain ways, and we're really just a part of this grand play, and we're playing out these certain stories and themes, and it's all been encoded within the DNA that we are basically connected to?
Well, there you're getting into people's personal view of, their religion. And so everyone has their own views on these things. I have mine. I believe that the soul is hyperdimensional and that this is a training ground. I think the movie Matrix comes close to modeling or giving an idea of the particular idea I have of what's going on, that this is a school we're in, so to speak. We're here to develop ourselves, and the real reality is not here. It's the afterlife. You know? And so this is the way we perfect ourselves so we can be better, interact better with other entities in our afterlife, which is totally far more amazing than you can ever imagine. I mean, you can't even begin to imagine what it's like on the other side. It's such a different experience. And it's, people who have gone, you know, like near-death experiences, and they've gotten a glimpse of it, they have not wanted to return. It's so beautiful for them. Usually they're told it's not their time and they have to come back. They have more work to do here. I believe that one day, when humanity has evolved enough, we could perhaps approach, I mean, maybe I'm being too idealistic, but I think we could approach the idea of heaven on earth, so to speak. In other words, evolving to such a high level that it might begin to approach what is in that beyond world. Who knows?
That would be wonderful. That would absolutely be wonderful. And let me ask you this, if I may. What do you think it would take to get the group consciousness, you know, this higher archetype of the human species here on Earth, or enough people to create this type of scenario? I mean, because it just seems right now, Dr. Paul, that the people that control the world as a whole, for the most part, are hell-bent on destroying this planet. It's like they're getting off on these wicked wars that really have no meaning, and just the way that the Borg is fueled, I guess you could say, the fuel that they feed this Borg mindset with is so negative. What is it going to take to put that spark in this abyss of darkness and change things?
If the U.S., for example, could declassify its free energy technologies, been developing in secret, which I know they've been developing, also their space propulsion technologies, that would do two things. Energy production would become incredibly cheap, and people could get from one point on the planet to another very, very quickly, like from New York City to Australia in 20 minutes. So it would be an incredible change economically for the planet. We would no longer be living in poverty. All economic advances have depended on two things: getting goods from point A to point B quickly and cheaply, and generating energy cheaply. Every time it was an advance in those two areas, humanity progressed. And for some reason, governments who have developed these things in secret, sort of hoarding them, thinking, oh, we can use this in wartime if we need to, you know, they've kept it from the public. And what they've done is, so they've strangled society. This was not supposed to happen. If there was a plan for this stuff to come out, like people, inventors, you know, they're inventing these things right along. The plan was that this stuff should have come out and been implemented. And we're, for the last 50 years, sort of like in a stasis, almost like in Matrix, you know, where everything got frozen at the 1960 level. So once we do that, it sort of, we'd be able to employ people to have their jobs making things better, like artists to make the place more beautiful, people to give careful thought as to how to do things a little better. Whereas, you know, when you're strapped for cash all the time, you can't do that. I mean, look at all the services they're cutting right now. I mean, we are living in a nightmare right now. I mean, this doesn't have to be this way.
I completely agree.
Yeah. And I think, you know, what will it take? I think it will take a catastrophe, a global catastrophe, a superwave. I call them galactic superwaves. That's written about it in my book, Earth Under Fire. One thing it does, and when the superwave would happen, everyone would see it. It would be like a bluish-white star in the sky. There might even be some earthquakes. And I think what would happen is people would start praying. I'm hoping that that would be the reaction, or at least a large fraction. The other fraction of people probably run stark raving mad through the streets. But if you get enough people praying, what happens? You get that synchrony you were talking about. I think there's a possibility to generate a sort of a global mindset towards love at that point. So that would be an opportunity where the world could make a total shift of consciousness. And at the same time, it will disturb normal activities of society so that power structures would be at a disadvantage. And that would be the time where new ideas, the new seeds that have been long in developing and have been even suppressed, these new ideas can then spring upward and take root. And we could make the transition.
Yeah, now that's a cool...
It would be nice if it didn't take a catastrophe, but the way things are going, every year I'm thinking, well, when is the super wave going to come, or whatever it's going to be, you know?
Right. It seems, though, it's getting worse and worse. In 2010, there's the nasty Gulf oil disaster, and then they spray core exit all over the place to suppress the oil that's coming out of the ground, and the core exit's even worse than the oil. And then the Fukushima disaster in Japan, 4 reactors blow up, the stuff's spreading mox mixture all over the planet.
Not to mention chemtrails, too. I mean, they're spraying.
Oh, yeah.
I was in Athens, and every Monday and Sunday and Monday, they'd be out spraying us. I don't know what the heck, what the reason is. They did some measurements, and they found barium in this stuff. Barium's a poison. So what are they trying to do, spray the Greek people into submission, kill them?
No, they're trying to spread pesticide, and, they're basically spraying stuff on people like they're cockroaches, and they can, cut down the population. They can have the planet for themselves, and not only the stuff you're talking about, those same salts, but there's also been links to all sorts of other physical ailments that people have had, and from last I checked, there's over 100 patents of chemtrail type technologies. And the aluminum is spraying in there, and some people say it's for geoengineering to protect the people, because if the temperature goes 3 degrees, if it raises 3 degrees, it'll change the entire planet to catastrophe. Yet it appears that these chemtrails that they're actually doing for weather manipulation, weather control, it's obvious they have these technologies to control the weather. And even William Cohen, Secretary of Defense back then, admitted to the Pentagon there was over a dozen countries that had access to weather control. So, the chemtrails and
have to spray barium? I mean, for weather control, can't they use something like iodine or something that's more healthy?
Right.
When these people do this stuff in secret and they're unaccountable, they can do whatever they want. And, somebody who comes along and says, hey, I have a better idea. Remember with the Gulf spill, there was a guy who said he had developed a bacteria that breaks all this down, and he couldn't get them to even try it. And it would have been one-tenth of the cost of what they were doing, and it would have cleaned up everything. So it's basically
look at the people that got straight
stupidity. We are ruled by stupidity, and that's unfortunate.
Hey, 23.
I was just real quick. I was gonna say it's not just stupidity, Paul. It's this negative demonic force almost. Like they actually know what they're doing, but they like to feed off of this dark energy and make people sick, so then they can sell more drugs that don't work. So it's just a perpetual cycle of madness. I absolutely agree with you there, Paul. Sorry about that, Finn.
I don't know. Just seeing these planes, it was disturbing. There was a psychological impact to me, and anger. you know. And the thing is, you know, they claim they're, if let's say they're doing it for weather control. The truth is, they're finding that the weather, it's more due to the sun. It's not due to CO2.
Exactly.
The sun has been more and more active, and now it's apparently cooling. You know, we've had lower solar activity, so there's a cooling trend, or at least it's not been warming like it used to. So the question is, what if the theories that are guiding them are wrong? You know,
it's all made up.
This at all, you see.
I agree 100%. Absolutely, Paul. You were 100% correct.
We are ruled by wrong theories. You know, all the way from the idea that the universe is expanding to the idea that the energy cannot be created spontaneously. All these are incorrect. I mean, there's been even people that have, like Sai Baba, he holds his hand out and Vibhuti materializes in the air. I mean, that's no trick. I mean, there are people that can materialize matter, you know. And
right.
There are some magicians who do this, but they don't tell you. They don't want to be strung up as witches, you know, so they earn money, you know, by performing tricks.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You are 100% right there, Paul. And I've read numerous reports of people, gurus in India and other places that can manifest things out of thin air, and have had thousands of people try to debunk them that weren't able to do so. Yeah, you're right. The elitists, they keep these technologies for themselves, and then they come out with this poppycock bullcrap, and they feed it to the masses so they can continue to do their, you know, just do whatever they want, and then they blame us and say we're the bad guys, and it's really unfortunate, Paul. You know, and I know that we've gone a little bit past the hour here, and we do have a few questions from our audience. I was hoping that you'd be kind enough to answer those before you take off. Is that okay?
Oh, okay, sure, yeah.
Hey, I really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Ben, you there? Or Isis?
Yeah.
Isis?
Oh, yes. Hello, Paul.
Hi.
My first question is from Seek Truth, and he asks, let me see here. I'm trying to get to this. Do you have any evidence of a galactic superwave in evidence today?
Okay. With a superwave, it travels at the speed of light. So when it gets here, when you see the light from the superwave, that's when the cosmic rays are already here. Now the question is, okay, the superwave comes from the center of our galaxy, for those who don't know. It's due to an explosive outburst of the supermassive core of our galaxy. We see these happening in other galaxies. They're called quasars or cipher galaxies. Those are galaxies whose cores are active. Now, the question is, does activity start gradually and build up over years and years? So let's say, would we see the core becoming brighter and we would be given some warning ahead of time? Or does it all of a sudden happen without warning? And out of the blue, suddenly we're hit with this thing. And I think it's the second, not the first, unfortunately. There was recently, you may have heard about it in the news, they were looking out with gamma ray telescopes, you know, these gamma ray bursts, and they recorded a very strong gamma ray burst from one galaxy, and the thing didn't stop. It kept going and going and going. It's still going. Okay, well, they said, oh, well, it must have been a black hole in the galaxy swallowing a star. Well, if that was the case, how come it's still going, you see? And I think what it is it's a core that turned on. It became a quasar. Now, so it took 3 minutes for that to go from zero to maximum. It came down a bit, but it came down about tenfold, but it still was hundreds of thousands of times brighter than our own galactic core. So if that is typical, it means these things can turn on in, let's say, 3 minutes. You don't have much warning, you know. So best thing is initially you stay indoors, you know, not be going out. If you see a bright star in the southern part of the sky, in the area of where Sagittarius and Scorpio would be, you know it's arrived. So don't expect that there's going to be any warning. It's like probably there wouldn't be any sirens, like fire sirens or anything. I think it would happen too quickly.
Okay, thank you. Now, what you're saying, does that mean that it's connected with the universal singularity emitting an energy wave?
Well, I don't know, universal singularity. You mean the core of the galaxy? That's where it originates.
Okay, that's good. Thank you. Now, Elquist Quantum would like to know if, not to go into religion, and unfortunately I was dropped, so I don't know if you've discussed this or not, but do you think maybe the center of the galaxy or the universe could be God or our creator? And also, do you believe in intelligent design?
Okay, answer the first, no. I don't believe the center of the galaxy is our creator. That would be making the creator so insignificant, sort of like a little ant, in comparison to what God really is. God is everything. And what we see is not everything. We're only seeing the physical universe. There's far more. I don't know if you can picture that there's infinite dimensions. And all we see are three dimensions, you know. If you've seen the movie The Neverending Story, does that ring a bell for some people?
Classic movie.
Yep.
Okay, that's basically a parable of what is existence. It's like one level after another. Sort of in that story, our minds were generating a universe that was real. And as long as people dreamt and imagined, that universe would continue to exist. Well, imagine that our universe is created by some phenomenon that, let's say, could be somebody dreaming in another dimension, which actually is getting to the story of Vishnu. The Hindus view that. That's their analogy of how the universe came into being, that it's Vishnu dreaming. So imagine that there's an infinite chain of dimensions of creations of realities, and I think that's starting to become close to that, and that God is all of that. No, God is creation in all of its forms, in forms you can't even imagine. You know, because our minds, all we can understand is what's here, but there's so much more, you know, out there.
Okay, thank you. I'm sorry. EB219 would like to know, he says, you mentioned Flatland earlier. Do you have any comment on the fourth dimension structure called Tesseract? And might this be the next interop step in evolution, a more refined complexity in geometry?
Okay, I don't know what that word is that you mentioned. What is it again?
He called it Tesseract. T-E-S-S-A-R-A-C-T. That's what he called it.
I have not heard of that. No, I don't know how to answer that.
He writes here, a tesseract combines a cube with the fourth dimension.
Yeah.
He says it's a fourth dimensional cube.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, you can. That can be, for example, a way of trying to visualize higher dimensions. You know, how would a cube look in four dimensions? So there's people that are good at doing that, and it definitely is difficult to do this, but it's, you know, would be a good exercise for people to get a feel for that.
Okay, thank you. I have a question, kind of like, when you explain this, that there are other dimensions and such, the first thing that came to mind to me was the nanotechnology and how the North Koreans have discovered other areas so tiny that, like on a film, there are literally layers and layers. And, you know, they're doing different testing, like light through gold and light through silver and things like that. And I was thinking of the statement, as above, so below. So, you know, if you go down through, into the smaller and smaller, it would make sense that there would be the larger and the larger dimensions as well. Is that a good analogy or not?
Well, we're still in physical 3D space when we go smaller and smaller. To talk about higher dimensions, it's like going beyond, sort of like maybe experience of when you get stoned, you go somewhere else. I don't know how to explain it. But the idea of as above, so below, I was struck recently as I've been updating Subquantum Kinetics for the next edition, which will be in the future coming out in electronic version, like an e-book. They found that what's called the cosmic web, I don't know if you've heard of this, that the all, if you plot where the galaxies are, it's sort of like they form this froth, but there's actual structure to it. It's sort of like a bubble structure, almost like waves of galaxies out there. And you find it's very similar to when you look at the subatomic level of the particle. The particle is a wave, but at the cosmic level, you have a wave of galaxies. And you could say as above, so below, in that sense, that there are these similarities. It's interesting.
Okay. Mr. E would like to know if what your opinion of Neil Adams and his expanding Earth theory is. And secondly, could you ask the doctor his opinion on the electric universe theory?
Okay, the first was about new atoms.
Like yes, atoms, new atoms.
Atoms
expanding Earth.
Expanding Earth is a different subject, right?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Well, with expanding Earth, I believe the Earth is growing, but so slowly that we probably can't measure it. There are people that talk about the Earth growing at enormous rates that I don't believe that's correct. The reason why the continents are moving apart in places is due to the standard theory. That's one area where I ascribe the standard theory of continental drift, you know, the movements of the crust. But the truth is that the Earth grows very, very slowly, and so does the Sun. But you can put limits on how fast that is, because for every time the Sun doubles its mass, its luminosity goes up 10,000 times. Or let's say if the Sun went up tenfold in mass, its luminosity would go 10,000 times up. All it takes is a 2% change of the Sun's luminosity to have us in the past be in an ice age where the Earth is frozen from pole to pole in ice. So that means that the sun's luminosity hasn't changed that much in 4 or 5 billion years. You know, it couldn't have changed more than a few percent. So if that's the case, that puts a real limit on how fast the sun is growing and therefore how fast the Earth is growing, because you can write equations. Subquantum kinetics, I write equations for these things. And you can extrapolate what you know about the sun to the Earth. And what was the something about electric universe? I don't know if everyone knows exactly about the electric universe, or maybe that's a theory, electric universe theory. And the question is that the theory that Alvain put forward about creation, or, you know, person would have to be more specific. That would be getting into another area, so maybe we shouldn't get into that.
Okay, thank you. Let's see. C-Punk would like to know, if we have no control over the universe, why worry about the gamma rays and the things that we can't change?
Yeah, you don't have to worry. I mean, if you die, you don't really die. I mean, that's my view. You just make the transition to another level. We, of course, are concerned about death because we have the preservation instinct that's ingrained in us. But it's really not that bad. You hear about people building underground shelters. In fact, stuff that's been done in secret by the U.S. government and by private groups. I heard about one gold mine being outfitted. It goes down 2 miles, and they built dwellings down there that people can purchase. You know, sort of the super rich can buy an underground shelter to survive an event like a super solar flare, extinction level solar flare, or super wave, or something like that. You know, some people believe that that these things can be averted with change of consciousness of the planet. I believe our minds can affect matter. They've done experiments in Princeton where take anybody off the street, he can make a plate move and change the interference pattern with a laser. If you get enough people praying, I believe they could steer cosmic rays right around our solar system so they wouldn't even hit us. You know, that's the power of collective prayer. I think it is very powerful. And we have yet to test it out on a large scale, but I believe that it's possible.
Okay, thank you. I have one question that's not on the general topic, but something that probably you more than anyone could answer. Patrick Bateman would like to know, what do you believe actually occurred during the Philadelphia experiment?
I write about that in Secrets of Anti-Gravity Propulsion. I have about 10 pages about that. Seems that Townsend Brown was involved, and there was efforts to cover up his involvement afterwards. They actually changed some documents, Navy documents, to make it look like he wasn't in the area at that time. They brought in like $50 million for the project he was working on. There was a boat of gold that was brought from England, I guess, at $50 million in bullion, and that went to fund something. And I suspect it was probably the Philadelphia project. Philadelphia experiment. In that experiment, they created invisibility, and it's something that's not explainable in standard physics, but it is explainable in subquantum kinetics, and I go into that in my book there. It has to do with changing the gravity potential of something. When you change gravity potential, you can make things materialize or dematerialize. Or change their invisibility, you can change their inertial mass. If you wonder why UFOs are able to quickly change their direction and do zigzag patterns, it's because they probably reduced their inertial mass to the mass of a basketball. You know, these things are possible in subquantum kinetics, not in physics.
Thank you. I was wondering, you had mentioned in one of the videos that I was watching about a cycle. You did ice core samples, and it was like 26,000 years, 13,000 years, 3,500 years. You had a different. Could you explain that, please? Or if you have already, then I'll listen to the podcast. Like I said, I was dropped. My server dropped me, so. But I would appreciate that. And Elquist Connell wants to know how much time you think we have left. Ties right into that.
Okay, well, my ice core samples, I was studying samples from Greenland, analyzing for cosmic dust content. I was testing the superwave theory, because I discovered a message that's passed down to the present. That gave dates about when, it was talking about a cosmic ray event, basically, that hit our planet back at the end of the Ice Age. And to test that, that's what I did for my PhD dissertation. And one of the tests I did was to look in samples of ice to see if I could find a lot of cosmic dust. Because if cosmic rays had come in from the galactic center, they would have pushed a lot of cosmic dust into the solar system, and we should have seen it. And, in fact, I did find high levels of cosmic dust. So that confirmed the theory. But in addition, other groups were studying the ice, and like from Antarctica, and they were looking at what's called beryllium-10, and that's an element that's produced in our atmosphere by cosmic rays. And they found that there's peaks at certain intervals, and I've interpreted those peaks as indicating times when galactic superwaves have arrived in the past. And I've done Fourier analysis of the data with help of a group in Washington, and we've come up with certain periods that you find in that data. One is around 25,000 years, another is around 11,500 years, and then there's something like around 5,800 years, which is close to the Mayan cycle. So you see a lot of these cyclic periods in the data. And we haven't had a really major superwave since the last major one ended around 11,000 years ago. There was a small event that lasted only about 20 years that happened around 5,300 years ago. So we haven't really experienced tough times for a long time. The people, our predecessors in Stone Age period, prior to 11,000 years ago, they were going through some really tough times.
Okay, I just thought that it tied in kind of like in the amount of time that it takes us to, do the, what do they call it? it's approximately 26,000 years, 26,000 years, and we travel all the way around to a new era or something.
Yeah, you mean the polar precession cycle, why we go through, like, the age of Pisces and Aquarius and so on?
I thought that was only a couple of thousand years, but to do all of them, it took, long.
Right. you go through the whole cycle, it takes almost 26,000 years. And the question is, why is there that cycle in the data? And I believe that it's because when a superwave arrives, it's not just cosmic rays. There's also a gravity wave associated with it. And the Earth gets pulled by a very strong gravitational force, and the Sun and all the planets. They get pulled towards the center of the galaxy. And that pulling creates a tidal force, just like the Sun and Moon do on the Earth. And that's going to give a kick to the Earth's polar precession. So basically, the polar precession cycle becomes entrained into a galactic superwave cycle. Because if you look at the dates of these cosmic ray peaks in the ice core data, these beryllium 10 peaks, they tend to line up at times when the Earth's polar axis was either directed towards the galactic center or away, 180 degrees away, the other direction. And that would have been favorable to give the Earth's precessional cycle an extra kick. You know, that would give it a maximum effect at those times.
Well, haven't they discovered, like in geology, about the Earth changes and rivers drying up and lakes drying up, and this happened approximately about those times? The rains move with the currents, and they vary in different. You think that was caused from the wave coming then?
Well, these are things that happened during the Ice Age and at the ending of the Ice Age. The super wave causes changes of glaciation, like it will either initiate or terminate an ice age, because superwave will bring cosmic dust into the solar system, and that changes the radiation flux on the Earth, because cosmic dust can either, for example, create a hothouse effect. It will reflect sunlight back onto the Earth, increasing the Earth's temperature. It can obscure the Sun and change the spectrum of the Sun, make it more towards the infrared. Cosmic rays themselves will cause cloudiness in the stratosphere. And cloudiness will tend to create cooling effects. So the whole thing is very complicated. If you tried to do a climatic model of a superwave, it would involve all sorts of effects, some which act against each other. So depending which effect was stronger than the other, you could have different results. So then during the Ice Age, of course, we had the ice sheets covering the Earth, and when things warmed up, you got what I call glacier waves. These are waves of meltwater crashing down from the ice sheets, so they're sort of like avalanches of water. And this can explain a lot of the geologic formations around the Earth, why you find Pleistocene mammals frozen in the tundra in Alaska and Siberia. It's in the myths of the Great Flood. That's a myth you find all over the world in all sorts of different cultures. There's hundreds of stories from different parts of the world that say the same thing. So this is something.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, and I think you mentioned that there would be a lot more earthquakes as well all over the world.
Yeah.
Okay, wonderful. Well, I really appreciate you answering all of our questions, even the ones that weren't quite on topic. And I'd like to turn the mic back over to 23 now. Rex?
Hey, thanks, Isis, and those are some awesome questions from the audience, and you too. I really appreciate that and the contribution that you guys have made tonight with us. So, and also, Paul, this has been great. I really appreciate you coming on here tonight with us and giving us some great information. It's really gone by super fast. I wouldn't pick your brain for 24 hours, but I know that you've got to get moving on. So I was just, before we close out tonight, I was wondering if there's anything else you'd like to let us know or share with us, and if you could give us your website again, and thanks again.
Yeah, well, it's etheric.com, and the other is starburstfound.org. And etheric.com has information about my various books, and there's also DVDs and CDs there. And there's also quite a few papers you can download for free. So, yeah.
Great.
I enjoyed being here and sharing these ideas with you. And I hope you found them interesting.
Well, not only myself, but everybody else did as well. And we, on GLP, we'll post the a thread at the beginning of the day, usually before the show, you know, so people can see that what guests we're going to talk to in the evening. And reading through the posts that were left on your thread, everybody had nothing but great things to say about you, just stellar praise. So, you know, thanks again for taking time out of your day here and spending it with us. And I'm going to, if you would, just stick with us for just 1 second after we do the close, and I'm going to turn the mic back over to Finn.
GLPBC's The Raw Feed would like to thank our guest, Dr. Paul LaViolette, for sharing with us his research and work into some quantum kinetics and other areas of science. Check out his books at his website, etheric.com and starburstfound.org. Thanks to the VC Team J, Isis Hubnuts, and 2342. Join us next week, folks. We have a special show Sunday afternoon, June 10th, 3 p.m., Lucy Wyatt, Approaching Chaos. Monday, June 11th, Aaron France, Transalchemy. Tuesday, June 12th, Liz Barris on the Dangers of Wi-Fi. Wednesday, June 13th, Patricia Baker, Zombies. Thursday, June 14th, Max Igon on Holographic Universe. That's it for tonight, folks. The podcast will be up shortly. This has been a GLP voice chat presentation. Good night, everyone.